Hello everyone, today I'm coming at you from the van. So we're out here today to talk about a recent upgrade that I did to my Chinese diesel heater installation that has just really paid back in spades. So yes, I have a Chinese diesel heater. A lot of people have these things and you might be considering one for yourself if you don't already have one. So in this video, what we're going to talk about is relocating the diesel tank from inside the cab to the engine bay. As a matter of fact, I actually had the diesel tank and the fuel pump in my cab. And that resulted in a few issues or inconveniences that I'm gonna get into. And yeah, like I said, I moved all that stuff to the engine bay and it's just been great. So specifically, we're gonna talk about relocating in this video. In future videos, I'm going to be talking about upgrading, different upgrades that you can do for the diesel heater, such as adding a third-party controller that's going to give you some additional features, like a wireless remote, adding a switch to be able to turn the display on and off. That's good for making it darker at night because the display can be a little bit distracting, and it also saves the LCD and the backlight in the display. Other great upgrades that we can talk about are some noise abatement from the pump, because the pump can be kind of loud. Tuning of the Chinese diesel heater to give you the maximum performance. And I'll probably end up going over the installation as well. So make sure you hit that like button, subscribe, and hit that bell so you're notified of all future videos. All right, let's get into this video. So first of all, let me go and show you where I have it installed. So there's the back of the van. Sorry about the mess. It is still under construction. And I've got my galley right here. And the diesel heater is installed right here in the floor. It takes up minimal space. And I really like that location. It's kind of central in terms of front to back. And the sleeping area is here. This is where my bed is. So I plan in the future to put a T on this, so part of the heat will go that way and part of the heat will go, I'm thinking about underneath the galley, and then I'll have a vent coming out over here and it'll disperse to this area or perhaps come out this way. But in any case, I used to have my tank, a 10-liter tank, up against this wall and an enclosure that I made for the pump here. And that enclosure was to help with sound from the pump. So this is the enclosure right here. It worked very, very well, but now that I've relocated the pump, I no longer need this. So that's great. It's less wasted space, less bulk that I have to carry around. But I'll probably do a video on this as well, how to make this box in case there are folks that want to have the pump in the cab. But that goes like that. This is some sound absorbing rubber and you've got a lid on it. So I'll show you in a minute just how much space that takes over there. And there's the 10 liter tank. So I don't even think I can fit this in. Well, I might be able to. Yeah, so the 10 liter tank used to be here. It was actually against this right wall, but I'll go ahead and put it over there against the left wall. Same difference. Pick this up for a second. So it was about like that. So as you can see, this took up a lot of space. As a matter of fact, this was underneath of that. In other words, the tank rested on top of this. So what that did is it pushed the tank up into this area. And it meant that I couldn't have like a drawer here or a shelf here as I do now, of course. And having this here just took up a lot of space down here, and it made it that I, you know, because it took up this footprint, I couldn't put, you know, any other items in here, any other taller items. So this space up here above it was essentially wasted. So now that I've moved the tank to the engine compartment and the pump, I actually said earlier that I moved the pump to the engine bay, but it's actually underneath the van. So I stand corrected on that. I'll show you where that is. But now that these two items are no longer here, I've reclaimed all of this space. And I've temporarily been able to put a microwave in here. And on our last camping trip, it was so nice to have a microwave. Before, we had a little 12-volt pan that had a heating element in the bottom, and it would just take forever to warm milk, or, you know, for oatmeal, or rewarm up our meals. So the microwave is definitely a clutch addition. That's going to go away in the future. In the future, I'm going to end up having a tall cabinet here, floor to ceiling. So once that's in place, we'll have the microwave somewhere in the middle. But for now, this is where we're at. And then I normally put a cooler over here, and it's just kind of nice to have all this space. In the future, this is probably going to be a couple of drawers. Before going to the engine bay, I should mention a couple of other reasons why I chose to move these items. So number one, obviously the pump is noisy, so not having the pump in the cab at all is fantastic. I mean, that made a huge difference. It made more of a difference relocating it outside than it did putting it in that case. And now it's almost silent. Before, even in this enclosure here, we were still able to hear it to the point that it was annoying. And then, apart from space, once again, another issue that's kind of, it's kind of two issues in one, it's regarding filling of this. So if you can imagine, when I had it in here, like I said, it was actually bolted up against the right hand side here, and I had three thumb screws that I could easily unscrew from here, and I could actually pop the thing off the wall, and I had enough slack in the fuel line that I could pull the tank out, and I could actually flip it around, and I would actually fill it from the outside. However, I always had this fear, first of all, of spilling it in the vehicle. And my understanding with diesel, it's oily, it's greasy, and it stinks. And my understanding is if you ever spill it, it's almost impossible to get rid of the oily residue and the smell, particularly if it gets underneath the floorboards. So it was a pain to fill, and I was definitely concerned about possible spillage. And of course, having even filling it properly and then containing it, keeping it in the van, did cause for a little bit of smell to linger for a time. And of course, I mean, I guess it's probably better not to have flammable liquids inside your cab, you know, in your living space. So, in summary, those are the reasons why I wanted to relocate these items. Okay, let's go take a look under the hood. So to the untrained eye, you might not even be able to tell what is stock and what is not. But this is my relocated diesel tank right here. So we went from being a 10-liter tank to a 5-liter tank. But the nice thing about the heater, and the nice thing about, well, living in Northern California anyway, is on low, the heater only consumes about 0.1 liters of diesel per hour. So that means with a 5-liter tank, I should be able to go about 50 hours. And that's plenty. I mean, you know, for me, that's, if I do like 10 hours a night, I can go for 5 nights, you know, call it a week. Here's the little bracket I made. It's literally just a piece of L extrusion, aluminum extrusion, and then I cut it to a particular length, cut it down the middle at the V, okay, at the intersection, and then I got rid of half of it, and then I just basically hammered the crap out of it, and I used pliers to form it in this way right here. There's a little bit of a lip that it needed to go over right here. This is a stock screw, so I simply drilled a hole in the aluminum there, and was able to utilize that stock hole. I drilled that hole in this bracket right here. This bracket is removed by simply taking out this bolt And then there's a teeny, teeny, tiny screw right there that needs to come out. Once those two items are out, this can be removed so you can easily drill that hole. And then this was a mess up, actually. I originally thought that I was going to try to build a bracket and then use that as a mounting hole. So that's literally just plugging a hole. But what these are right here is I just got these at Home Depot. They're basically just, they're like bolts, but without the bolt head. I don't know what you call them. But I drilled a smaller hole, a much smaller hole in the tank. And then I just screwed this in so that it makes essentially a watertight or a diesel tight seal. So even when the diesel is sloshing around in here from driving, it doesn't really tend to leak out of these holes. There's a hole here and there's a similar one of these right there. So obviously there's a hole under there in the tank and it doesn't leak out. Of course, you can see I don't keep this topped off all the way to the very, very tippy top either. I leave a little bit of room in there. I have a feeling if it was much higher, then these actually might leak. Going over this a little bit more. So I just drilled a little hole in the L bracket here, drilled a little hole there. And then I just cut two little pieces of aluminum bar stock. And there's the wing nuts right there. So the wing nuts just screw onto bolts that go onto these factory holes here. So you can see the two wing nuts. And I mean, it's a real simple bracket, but it works really well. I mean, you can see just how sturdy that is. That's something else I made. I'll go over that at the end of the video. It's basically a funnel, and it just happens to fit perfectly in here. And then I drilled another teeny hole right there. And again, the hole was drilled intentionally to be smaller than what I was going to put inside. This is just the stock hard nylon tubing that comes with the Chinese diesel heater. So I've just got that fed in there. Another kind of little innovation that I have is I actually have that going all the way inside, and then I attached my fuel filter to the end of that. So my fuel filter is not in line down there somewhere. It's actually in the tank, which I kind of like. And I angled it in such a way that, I don't know if you can see this, but the tank actually tilts like this. So that means that any debris that happens to get into the tank is going to collect in this corner right here. And I have the entrance of the fuel filter actually pointing over here. So with any luck, sediment will collect in the corner and it won't ever be brought into the fuel filter. And then eventually the fuel filter will need to be replaced, and at that time I'll flush out any sediment that happens to be in there. But next, I'll just kind of show you guys how I ran this line. This is basically Tygon tubing. I think it's a knockoff made by this company called Oregon, but the properties of it are the same. And as always, I'll leave links in the description to anything that I think will be helpful. All right, let's go ahead and take a look at the route of the fuel line and the pump underneath the vehicle. Okay, I hope this isn't too hard to see, but basically you can see the fuel line there, and that really leads right up the back of the engine bay and then into that tank. And then wherever possible, which actually was everywhere, I just tried to use factory provided attachment points. So there's some kind of electrical wire right here that's in like a cable guard, and that leads all the way to the back. So I kind of fished it up in there using both arms. There it is. And you can see it just runs right along. And then there's a point here, an attachment point that kind of restrains that that factory cable. There's another one. I go on the other side of the heat shield, and then it just keeps on going. Okay, so here we are.
More.
And then there's this kind of bulkheady thing that goes from one side of the vehicle to the other. And I ran it along the back side of that. I'll show you that now. Okay, so there's the front of the vehicle. All the way. And then again, there's some factory restraining clips there. And I go all the way to the other side. And then I come up right there. And that's my fuel pump. And then I come up through a hole in the floor right there. So let's go check that out. Okay, there's the back of the van. And here's the fuel line. It's still a bit of a mess. I need to clean this up. And I actually wanted to shoot this video because I'm going to go ahead and cover this in the same type of like plastic conduit that we saw over there that the factory used to protect those electrical wires. So I've got a giant spool of that, and I'm just going to protect all of this. I'm going to cut it to length as well. It's too long. And I've still got to do something with this pump. It's just kind of sitting up here right now, and I don't like the fact that it's exposed to the elements. It's going to be exposed to splashing water and things like that, so I'm probably going to enclose it in like a really big heat shrink tubing, and then I'm gonna shrink it down. So this entire thing should be pretty enclosed, and I'll probably try to put some silicone on both ends just to keep the water out. Of course, it'll be like sort of hermetically sealed. So if I ever need to do any maintenance on this, I'll just have to cut the whole thing and, you know, remove it and then redo it. But no big deal. Better safe than sorry. So then I've got two holes drilled here. I didn't want to have the electrical right next to the fuel just in case there was any kind of a, you know, a scrapage here or scrapage here. I didn't want like a spark or something like that to potentially ignite the fuel. I think the chances of that would be super slim anyway, but again, better safe than sorry. I do need to still do some work on these holes as well. I've made sure that there's no rough edges, but after I cut all this to length and it's been finalized, I want to squirt some caulking in there just to keep these from moving. Because the more moving you get, the more moving you have, the more rubbing you'll have between these two, you know, between the wires and the metal of the floor, and the more chance you'll have of these deteriorating over time. So obviously we don't want that. All right, so let's take a look now. Yeah, inside. So that's where it comes up in the floor. And then, so it's right there. And then if we come over, there's the diesel heater. So yeah, I mean, that's about it. I think it's of all the different things that I've had to do on the van, this was one of the most simplest things to do and one of the most rewarding. I mean, getting that space back in the van, being able to put that microwave in, not having to have smelly diesel anymore, not having to listen to that clicking noise. And it really didn't take that long either. Once I came up with the design for this bracket, and that's one reason I wanted to share this design, is because I really did have to think about it quite a lot. And I wrestled with a couple of different ideas. But once I came up with this bracket idea, you know, it probably took me a couple of hours to fabricate that. But once I did, I just felt like I had definitely made the right choice for so many different reasons. It just fits in there real nice. Like I said, I like the way that it tilts to one side so that the sediment will collect in one corner. This filling cap here definitely has clearance. You have to make sure that you leave clearance for this right here. So keep an eye out for that. But if you do what I did, and you put the tank in like this, and you fashion a bracket to orient the tank like this you should have all the clearance you need. There's another thing you've got to look at. You see, you got to make sure you have clearance on the hood, and this fits just perfectly when the hood comes down. So like I said, if you orient your tank like this, and there's really only one way it can go, because you have a couple of constraints. You've got this piece of metal, piece of plastic right here that's part of the headlight assembly that essentially blocks it from going too much to the right. Over here on the left, you've got, I don't know what this is, but you know, this kind of metal bracket that's got some wires going into it, and so it really can't go too much more to the left. You could probably go a little bit further to the back, I guess, but the further back you push it, the further back your filling nozzle is going to go, and you're going to get to the point where it gets difficult to fill or impossible to fill. You're not going to have enough room to have your hand. So it's kind of a logical placement, front and back, left and right. And yeah, once you put it in there, like I said, you should be able to figure out how to make this bracket. And of course, I'm always open to any questions. Now, the next thing that I said I was going to talk to you about was this cool funnel idea I came up with. So if I don't want diesel in the van, I don't want a stinky funnel that's going to leak all over the van inside either. So, I mean, look at that. I can practically throw it in there and it just fits perfectly. It kind of gets caught on this little plastic thing here that's part of the battery cover. It rests upon this wire right here, which is the release for the hood latch. I don't know, it just fits perfectly in there, just like that. And this mouth, you know, rests perfectly on the tank on one side, and you know, it's just not really much wiggle room at all. And of course, if you can imagine, if the hood is down, even if I go over a significant bump, it's not going to really be able to go too far. So this thing is great. Now let me show you how I made this thing. It's super simple. Woo! Spring loaded. So you can pick up this filler right here from just about any auto parts store. I happen to get mine from Pep Boys. That's just PVC pipe, and I'll put the exact specifications of what it is in the description. This is a type of a plug. The dimensions of it are actually right there. It says Dura USA, 1/2 inch by 3/4 of an inch, IPS, and then there's some, but yeah, it's just a PVC plug. And what I did was I just took some bungee cords that I had. These bungee cords have this kind of a connector on both ends. I just cut the bungee cord connector off on one side, so I just had bungee cord. I melted the ends using a lighter, and then you can kind of see the ends right there. And what I did is I just fed the bungee cords into the plug and then pulled them back out, and hold this with my feet, pulled them back out, and so I had them coming out this way. And then I just hammered on this plug, forced it in there, and that effectively pinched these bungee cords so they're not going anywhere. And then I just cut the bungee cords, and that left me with this. So with this, oh, let me show you something else I did. I also drilled some holes in there. You see that? That was because I actually noticed that some water did collect in here, and I think it's because of the location of this. So perhaps we had some rain and some water got in to the funnel, or it could have been from the windshield washers. But in any case, I noticed that there was a little bit of water that had collected in there. You can kind of see it's a little bit discolored down there, so I wanted it to be able to drain out. But in any case, the way this works, just put that in there like so, and then you pull the bungee cords up. I'll see if I can do it with my foot as my other hand. Oh boy, it's slippery. There's one. Okay. And then I'll do the other. And that way, it stays just like that. Now, I had mentioned I didn't want, a leaky diesel fuel leaking in my vehicle. Well, I also don't want it to be leaking in my engine. And so, despite the fact that I drilled those holes in there, it's not leaking, because what I do is I just make sure that I wipe this down real nice with a paper towel when I'm done. And I even shove a paper towel down inside so that it absorbs any residual diesel. And then after, the next time I happen to open the hood, I just pull that out and toss it. But yeah, that baby rests in there. So that's just about it for the video. Okay, so a couple of the upgrades I'll talk about in another video. One of them is adding a switch to your control display. So it literally only powers off the controller, or I really should say the display, because the control board, is actually inside the diesel heater itself. So what's happening is the control panel programs essentially the control board in the diesel heater, and once the diesel heater control board has been programmed, you can actually disconnect the display, and as long as you don't have to make any changes, the diesel heater will continue to operate as it was last instructed. Therefore, you can turn this off. So I just added a little switch. But you got to add it to very specific lines on the controller. So of course I've upgraded my controller as well. Okay, so this is a different model. One of the features that it brings to the table is the ability to remotely control your heater. So it's got its own thermometer in here. It's got its controls. So what we usually do is we keep this over by the bed. That way we don't have to get out of bed in order to make changes. Regarding additional noise abatement. So let me go ahead and give you a preview of that. So that little guy right there is a fuel dampener. It costs about $10 to $15. The price has actually gone way up since these started getting popular. I bought mine for $5. I posted it on a Facebook group, and after that it went up to like $12 in just a matter of weeks, and then $15, and I think they're now $25. But anyway, you can see partly what it's doing is a right angle thing, but inside of there is a dampener, and I'm not exactly sure how it works. I'll cover it in another video after I have a chance to do some research, but believe me, you want to get one of those. So that pretty much wraps up this video, and I hope you found it helpful. I think moving that fuel tank to the front and relocating the pump to the outside are two of the best things you can do for your Chinese diesel heater. So I hope you found that helpful. If so, the only thing I ask is that you hit that like button. Please subscribe for future videos and make sure you hit that bell icon so you'll be notified when I actually post them up. And like I said, I'm going to do some more regarding the Chinese diesel heater. All right, guys, see you on the next one.